Shall we pray? Father, give me the spirit of wisdom and revelation that I might know you. Lord, open the eyes of my heart that I might know, Lord, the hope to which you have called me. And teach me to walk in that hope every day. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. I want you to turn to one of those familiar portions which we have looked before years back. But turn with me to Genesis chapter 27. And we're going to read from verses 1 to 8. Now it came to pass when Isaac was old and his eyes were so dim that he could not see, that he called Esau his older son and said to him, "My son." And he answered him, "Here I am." Then he said, "Behold, now I am old. I do not know the day of my death. Now therefore, please take your weapons, your quiver and your bow, and go down out to the field and hunt game for me, and make me savory food, such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat, that my soul may bless you before I die." Now Rebekah was listening when Isaac spoke to Esau his son, and Esau went to the field to hunt game. So Rebekah spoke to Jacob her son, saying, "Indeed, I heard your father speak to Esau your brother, saying, 'Bring me game and make me savory food for me, that I may eat it and bless you in the presence of the Lord before my death. Now therefore, my son, obey my voice according to what I command you.'" We know the story very, very well. We know the story very, very well, but we shall look at the story in the light of what we've been studying. There are four people here in this story. Dad, mom, and two sons, the twins. And we've been studying about love. And we shall see, there's only one love that is true. That's the love of God. And God is constantly trying to bring us to that love. Every other love will fail. Ultimately, it has a beginning and it has an end. But there is only one love that will never fail. That's God's love, or God's kind of love. And God wants us to bring us to that. That's what scripture says, only in two places. One, God never fails. That is Zephaniah 3:5. And also in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, scripture says, love never fails. Okay, the entire scripture, only twice it is mentioned. God never fails. He never fails. And then in 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 8, 13, it says, love never fails. And if you know, at least now in your head, we know in our head, we know from scripture, that there is only one kind of love that never fails, then if you don't want to be a failure, we need to ask constantly for that. Now the question when we look at the portion we read is, here is Isaac, here is Rebekah. How can a man who began so well, and a woman, when we first see her, Rebekah, who begins so well, end up with such a dysfunctional family? See, right from Genesis chapter 4, please accept this fact. The earth is full of dysfunctional families. Okay, so if anybody is sitting there griping that I am because I come from a dysfunctional family, remember, there are only dysfunctional families. But the good thing is that the living God takes dysfunctional people and through his love makes them functional in his kingdom. Only he can do that. Isaac, no man probably had a better start than Isaac. You couldn't dream of a better start. But let's look at the portion. Scripture says, now it came to pass when Isaac was old and his eyes were so dim that he could not see. There's nothing wrong with blindness, physical blindness, can still function. And can function quite well spiritually. But there's a problem with spiritual blindness. Read Ode to Blindness by Milton. And you will see spiritual truths over there, which most people don't even find after walking with God for seasons. So blindness. And he wrote it when he was blind. But spiritual blindness is dangerous. Because that's not the way God intends for any one of us. Scripture says, as we grow in Christ, we are being renewed from glory to glory. That means even though we are perishing outwardly, physically, our eyes may grow dim, our hearing may become weak, our physical strength might wane, but spiritually God says you are getting more and more sharp. More and more sharp. At least we are supposed to. But in this case, here is this wonderful man, when he began, declining spiritually. He's spiritually declining. The greatest role of a father in the house, in the home, is to affirm two things. One, the word of God and the will of God in his home. That's his duty. It's the duty of the father. To affirm both the word of God and the will of God in his home. That's the father's duty. Here, we will see, now that he's old, Isaac is actually living in denial of both the word of God and the will of God. That can happen to any one of us. It can happen to any one of us. Actually, when we grow older, we move more and more in affirming the word of God and the will of God in our lives and in our homes. At least in our own lives. In spite of God's instruction concerning Jacob's position over Esau, in spite of Jacob's inclination for the things of God and Esau's for the things of the world, Isaac now is determined to give the blessing to Esau. That's the interplay of words if you read scripture very carefully. Come further down. Now, Rebecca was listening. Look at verse 5 and 6 carefully. What are they? Twins. Okay? Dad and mom and twins. Rebecca was listening when Isaac spoke to Esau, his son. So Rebecca spoke to Jacob, her son. There's a division already. Dad favors one son. Mom favors another son. That's why I said there is no love on earth except the love that God sheds abroad in our hearts that is perfect. Every human love, nature of human love, is conditioned by the recipient. And even parents are susceptible to it. Isaac loves Esau. Rebecca loves Jacob. Genesis 25 and verse 28 will also tell you why Isaac loves Esau. Isaac loved Esau because he ate of his game. But Rebekah loved Jacob. Can be a little thing, and we don't even realize it. We all may have it in our hearts. Whether you're a father or not, you may still choose to like somebody more than somebody else because that somebody has something which you like. And we may be really feeling, I really love that person. God says it's false. It's not true. It's never true. Isaac liked meat and Esau liked hunting. So it's a good combination. And Isaac must be truly thinking, I really love my son. And scripture says there, Rebecca loved Jacob. The question is, why do we love? In the world we say, love is blind. But God's love and the love of God in us is never blind. It always, let me tell you, it always operates within the confines of God's word and God's will. It's never blind. it is never blind. Actually, God's love sees better than physical eyes. This false love Isaac has for Esau and Rebekah has for Jacob, you will see, both will carry to great lengths the father to outwit the will of God, and the mother to outwit and deceive a blind husband. Question is, how much of our love is similar to the love of Isaac and Rebekah? Were their feelings real? Yes. Were their feelings true? No. Next question, will God love me that way? No. He will not. His love is always true. See, both Isaac and Rebekah have declined spiritually with age. Isaac is now preoccupied with carnal desires. Actually, one desire. And in his old age, he tries to manipulate the will of God. And it is all based on false love. This is where we have to be very, very careful, because we can try to manipulate the will of God because of false love. We may love something very much, and try to interpret God's will for us around that, thinking that because I love it so much, God also must be loving it so much. There is already division in the home. There is a wall now between the husband and the wife. It's been there probably for some time now, built over years. Isaac doesn't share what he is going to do with Rebekah. Why? Scripture says Rebekah was listening. He didn't share it with Rebekah. See, when love grows deeper with age and time, you actually end up sharing everything. That's the nature of love. Any relationship, friends, spouses, family, even God. When the relationship of God with Abraham grew, and God was going to judge Sodom and Gomorrah, he said, how can I do this without consulting with my friend Abraham? Are you seeing it? But here, there is something wrong, which happens, can happen, all marriages. One of the signs of true intimacy, true love, is there are no secrets. Where there are secrets, that also means there is stuff to be hidden. God doesn't want to hide anything from us. But before God can share, he wants to bring us so that our love is true. And he brings his disciple to a stage and finally tells them, I will not call you servants anymore. I want to call you friends. I have told you everything what the Father told me to tell you. I haven't kept anything from you. And here Isaac has been keeping stuff from Rebekah, and Rebekah has been keeping stuff from Isaac. Let it not happen in our marriages. Sometimes, or quite often, men make this mistake of not leaning on their wife when they actually know their spiritual discernment is better. They don't. Some of you men should realize that your wife sometimes hears better when they see God's face than you. I always acknowledge it. My wife hears better any day than me. I won't say she preaches better. I wouldn't say that. But definitely she hears better. So outside of God, if you ask me on whose advice I lean most on, it's my wife. Not because she is my wife, but because she hears from God. Eve did not hear from God. That's why God told Adam, why did you listen to your wife? But Sarah was right in the decision she was asking Abraham to take. So God asked Abraham, listen to your wife. When there was a tumult years back in her womb, it was Rebecca who went and sought from the Lord and heard exactly what God's will was for those twins. And now it was time to impart the blessing. Isaac should have definitely asked Rebecca, "Rebecca, I think I'm going to die. I think it's time to bless our children." But he didn't ask. And I'm telling you, men sitting here, especially those who have a calling on their lives, learn to share, learn to lean, learn to seek, because where one can put 1,000 to flee, two can put 10,000. That's why Rebecca is listening. She overhears, and she has options like any one of us. Option number one, wife, when you know you are right and your husband is wrong, respectfully confront with love concerning the decision. Remind him it is against the revealed will of God. And as the husband and as the head of the house, it's your duty to uphold the will of God over and above your feelings. Respectfully, with love, confront. If Isaac was going to be stubborn, she still had the option of going to God in prayer, as she did when she had conceived. She had prayed, and God had answered. And now she could go back on the same format and remind God of His word and ask Him to intervene. Who knows if she had done that, Esau would have come back with nothing. Who knows, instead of Esau knocking off a deer, the deer would have knocked him off and he would have been lying there with a broken leg until Jacob got his blessings. God has done even stranger things as answer to a parent's prayer. But she didn't do. She didn't intervene. Remember Abigail? She was a wife, very wise wife. And God intervened on her behalf. She was married to a foolish man who was forever making foolish decisions and putting her family's life at stake. She intervened, but intervened very wisely, very respectfully, and very prayerfully. And you know what? I believe God answered her prayers. In 1 Samuel chapter 25, verse 38, there is a verse which says, "And it happened after about 10 days, the Lord struck Nabal and he died." She didn't intervene directly. She intervened and actually saved her husband's life. And then came back when he was sober, he told her husband as to what he had done and what she had done. Very wisely, very respectfully, she intervened in the whole situation. And then God intervened. So like I said, there are different ways God intervenes. God has 1,000 ways to intervene. Rebecca could have asked God to intervene and saved her home. But the problem is she starts plotting to get the blessing for her favorite son. It's no longer God's will. Though it is God's will, her primary concern is not God's will. It's her feelings for her son. So that love is false. But remember, it is all done in the name of love. And in the world, people do a lot of things in the name of love. Almost, most of it is false. You will see both the children ultimately took after their parents, the ones who influenced them. Isaac became careless about the things of God as he grew older and was willing to subvert the will of God for meat. Esau was careless for the things of God and was willing to sell the birthright for a pot of stew. Rebecca was willing to deceive her husband to get that blessing for her favorite son. So the son took after her and was willing to deceive his father and anybody who came on the way. That is why the love of everybody in this story is false. Are you getting the picture? You have to be very careful because children take after parents. Have a way of taking after parents. The Word of God says, obey your parents. But the Word of God never says, obey your parents at the cost of your obedience to God, or God's will, or God's ways. It never says. Twice in her address to Jacob, she says, in verse 8, now therefore, my son, obey my voice. In verse 13, she says, his mother said, let your curse be on me, my son, only obey my voice. God never demands any child to obey the voice of the parent over and again above obeying the voice of God. Not even a wife does he demand. He says, wife, submit your husband as unto the Lord. Are you getting the picture? You can misuse authority. An authority that is given by God. The office is given by God. The office of the father and the mother is given by God. That is why God says, honor your father and mother. If you dishonor, you will run into trouble with me. Because you may look at them as frail failures. But remember, they hold an office which was given by me. And you disrespect them, you disrespect me. And it will not go well with me. But when it comes to obedience, ultimately we obey God. Can you see why it doesn't necessarily mean if you have the best start in the world, the best home in the world, the best parents in the world, you can still end up a failure? You cannot have two better parents than Abraham and Sarah. One is called friend of God, father of believers. The other one is the only lady in the entire New Testament whom God says, women, be like her. Sarah. Isaac has Abraham and Sarah has his father and mother. And it began so well. Any father would be so proud if he gets a son whom he can tie up on the table and he doesn't move. Sometimes when we have children very small, we wanted to tie them up. Because they can't get out of hand. That here is a son who is never out of hand and allows his father to tie him up on the altar and raise a knife and he doesn't even blink. When it is time for marriage, oh, look at this man. He's meditating, fasting, praying for a bride whom his father is picking. What about Rebecca? What a girl who, as soon as he knows this is the will of God and her brother says, come on, let's feast for 7 days. She says, no, I will go tomorrow. Do you know this man? No. Why do you want to go tomorrow? Because that's the will of God. The question is, years later, where are you both? Am I touching anybody today? Somebody who began well, ran for a season, and then got off the race. That's why the first commandment is an ongoing relationship with God. Love God with all your heart, all your might, all your strength. It is an ongoing relationship. Keep loving God through it all, even as you grow old and grow older and grow older. Maybe you are parents today, maybe you'll be grandparents tomorrow, whatever. Keep your relationship with God ongoing. Because the only love that is true is the love that is based on truth. God's love. That love never fails. It cannot fail because it is based on truth. So in this whole story, there is only one love that is true. That is God's love for Isaac. God's love for Rebecca. God's love for Esau. And God's love for Jacob. And in his love, God lets Isaac, Rebekah, and Esau fade away from the story. You know that? He just lets them go. I believe, under my calculations, Isaac was 138 years old when he took this decision. But he dies 42 years later at the age of 180. 42 years of his life has no mention in the Word of God. Because he loved somebody more than he loved God and was willing to subvert the will of God. Rebecca is young, not very old. Rebecca fades away from the history in the book of Genesis. I don't know why. Why she fades that way? It's strange. It's very, very strange. If you study scripture carefully, Rebecca's death is not mentioned. Scripture mentions Rebecca's nurse who came from her father's house, Deborah, died and was buried, but Rebecca's death and burial is not mentioned in scripture at all. I don't know why, because God seems to have issues with those who subvert God's will. I don't know. I cannot even presume why Rebecca just disappears. Esau got what he wanted. What he wanted? Not the blessing. He wanted money. Once he had money, he also fades away. 33:9 reflects Esau's entire character. Esau said, "I have enough. Who is bothered about the firstborn's blessing? I connected with material prosperity. I have plenty." That's all that mattered to him. So God lets these three people fade away. But God continues his work on Jacob. Don't let God's presence fade away from our lives. Jacob flees the dysfunctional home and is forced to fend for himself. The good news, as I said before, is dysfunctional people from dysfunctional homes can become truly functional in God's kingdom. But it won't be easy, because sin has consequences. And the consequences of Jacob's sin will follow him. We saw this years back in that message on sowing and reaping. If we sow in the flesh, we will reap in the flesh. If we sow in the spirit, we will reap in the spirit. It doesn't change. Let me tell you, church, it doesn't change for anybody, because it's an eternal principle. The question is, can God work on Jacob? If God can work on Jacob, God can work on anyone sitting here. Think. Can God really change this man? Has he messed up too much for God to change him? I know many of you are struggling. You have struggled. And your struggles are not hidden from God. Some of you really want to give up, saying this is too much. This fight is too much. Some of you have settled like Esau. I have enough. I'm okay. Some of you have settled like Esau. Give me what I want. I will bless anybody. Some of you think, I can still manipulate and get God to do what I want. But God's desire is that He wants to make all of us like Him. That's His desire. You know what Jesus says? Jesus says, be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Question is, what does this mean? Let me honestly ask you this question. Can we ever be perfect like God in this life? No, we cannot be. Can we be perfect in holiness? No. Can we be perfect in knowledge? No. Can we be perfect in power? No. Can we be perfect in our ways? No. then why would God say, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect? Because God says, there is one area in everybody's life here where you can actually be perfect. Look at the context in which he says that. And the message is all around that. God wants us to become perfect in that area. Matthew chapter 5 verses 43 to 48. You have heard it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. That you may be the sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Therefore, you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. He says, there is one area everybody sitting here, everybody who will hear over the weeks, can become perfect. He says, you can be perfect in love. That, he says, is possible. You can be perfect in your love. I can take you to that point where you can be perfect in love. And one of the primary features of God's love, you know what? Is that love always gives. What is the nature of human love? Human love always takes. It expects. And if it doesn't meet its expectation, its nature changes. It shuts down. It refuses to do anything. It gets angry. It moves away. But not God's. Not God's love. So the question is, can Jacob be redeemed? Can this man be redeemed? Even when he flees after all this, he runs because his father and mother says, run, because your brother is planning to kill you. Mother says, go to my brother's house. Even after experiencing God in a divine moment at Bethel, he still is bargaining with God. He's saying, Lord, I liked all that I saw. Now I'm going, and if you really prosper me, I shall give you 10%. God must have said, thank you, finally I'm going to get something from somebody. Can Jacob be redeemed and be confirmed in the image of Christ? Can God make a giver out of this taker? Question. Can God make a giver out of these takers? Now let's get into a little serious stuff. There are two spirits operating primarily over mankind. The spirit of Christ, you want to know the nature of that spirit? Look at the cross. It gives. It always gives. Christ gives, for God loves, he gives. And Christ is not concerned about glory or reputation, but he is consumed by love for God and his neighbor. Contradicting this is the spirit opposite to this, the spirit of the Antichrist. Satan's pride, the reason for his fall, is because of self-focus. He wanted the glory and the power of God without his character. Do we want the glory and the power of God without the character of God? Then, be careful. It's the wrong spirit that is operating in us. Self-focus, selfishness, and pride are triplets, closely connected. And all the four in this story became totally focused on self. Isaac became carnal and wanted to satisfy his self. And therefore he was willing to pass on what was of God to the one who pleased his self. Rebecca focused on one manship. Upmanship. How to circumvent and satisfy her flesh without submitting to the authority of her husband. Esau focuses only on self. He wanted something he didn't deserve, neither desired. But when he lost it, he's saying, poor me. Oh, poor me. I've lost my blessing. And Jacob, I want it. Simple, I want it. I like it. And I'm willing to go any length to get it. Did you see how the devil infiltrated a godly home? Getting four people to focus on themselves. It's very simple. His tactics are very simple. What does he tell you? Spend more time before the mirror than before the mirror of God's word. Just focus on yourself. Jesus said, the law and the prophets, everything hangs on these two commandments. Love God with all your heart, all your might, all your strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. And all four, Isaac, Rebekah, Esau, Jacob, broke the law and the prophets. Please know this, the Antichrist spirit will take our focus off God and off our neighbor and make us focus on ourselves. Question, hypothetical question. Can I focus on my problems and solve them? Can I focus on my problems and solve them? Answer, spiritually, if you're a child of God, no. Because one of the problems is self-focus itself. You cannot. Because part of my problem is I am focused in self. So I can never solve my problems by focusing on myself. Because the answer lies is focus on God. God says, walk with me and I will address your problems. Galatians 5 verse 16, in very simple terms, he says, I say then, walk in the spirit and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Simple, they don't focus on self. Walk in the spirit. The problem here is, unlike the dictionary which gives you meanings, in the Bible, love is a verb. It's an action word. And God says, if we have broken, lost the capacity to love God and to love our neighbor, that we are no longer giving and we don't like giving, and you are expecting today an instant cure at the end of this meeting, I'll be restored and my love will be like God, you will be badly disappointed. It doesn't happen like that. Simple things. You learn hammering by? You learn to use a hammer by hammering. You learn to type by typing. You learn to read by reading. You learn to love by loving. You don't learn it any other way. And the more you love, the more you give. The more you give, the more you love. There is no other way. There is no other way. You cannot learn it anywhere else. Because God said, give and it shall be given unto you. What? Even more capacity to give. Even more capacity to love. There is no other way. If you and I want to learn to love like God, not false love, real love. What is real love? Last Sunday we saw real love. Our love is conditioned by the recipient. If I like him, I will love him. If he's from my own strata of the society, I feel more inclined to love him. If he's educated, wow, I like it. Well, if he speaks English well, I can love him a little more. And if you are somebody who's into music and he or she likes music, wow, I really love him. Our love is absolutely false because all our love is conditioned by the recipient. It's all conditioned by the recipient. Isaac's love for Esau was conditioned by Esau. Rebekah's love for Jacob was conditioned by Jacob. everybody's love, there is faults. So the question is, can Jacob be redeemed? How do we redeem Jacob? How does God redeem us so that He can make us perfect like the Father? The whole thing will either fail or succeed in Genesis 29. In Genesis 29, after a long, tiring, weary journey, Jacob reaches his uncle's home. And Jacob went on his journey and came to the land of the people of East. And he looked and saw a well in the field. And behold, there were three flocks of sheep lying by it. For out of that well they watered the flocks. A large stone was on the well's mouth. Now all the flocks would be gathered there, and they would roll the stone from the well's mouth, water the sheep, put the stone back in its place on the well's mouth. And Jacob said to them, "My brethren, where are you from?" And they said, "We are from Haran." Then he said to them, "Do you know Laban the son of Nahor?" And they said, "We know him." So he said to them, "Is he well?" And they said, "Oh look, his daughter Rachel is coming with the sheep." Then he said, "Look, it is still high day. It is not time for the cattle to be gathered together. Water the sheep and go and feed them." But they said, "We cannot until all the flocks are gathered together and they have rolled the stone from the well's mouth." Yeah, hang on. Well's mouth. "Then we water the sheep." This man has come tired, weary, and he comes and reaches a well. In the Bible, a lot of things happen at the well. Lot of young men meet young girls at the well. Those days, that was the dating point. Okay, because that's where the women come. But think about this. The flocks are there, the shepherds are there, they said, "We gather all the sheep and finally we roll the stone and we water the sheep." And they say, "It is not time yet, there's still more flocks to come." At that time, Rachel comes. Now while you are still speaking with them, Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she was a shepherdess. And it came to pass, when Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, that Jacob went near and rolled the stone from the well's mouth and watered the flock of Laban, his mother's brother. Jacob fell in love with Rachel. And love? What does love do? Gives. Suddenly he got some muscles in his hand, he rolled the stone and started drawing water. I sure one eye was on that girl. God must have been tickled pink in heaven and says, "Got you. I can redeem you. I can redeem you. Now I can work on you. Now I can work on you." You get into any relationship where people have fallen in love, they start doing things. Am I right? And when they stop doing things, go back and ask them, "Why did they stop?" Because love's nature is, it gives. It gives. It's truly a case of love at first sight. But let me tell you something. In English we say, the early bird gets the worm. Of course here the worm is Jacob. And God actually calls him in another place, "Jacob, you worm, caught by the bird Rachel." Did you notice something about specific women in the Bible? Those who ordained by God, marriages ordained by God, special women mentioned in the Bible: Rebecca, Rachel, Abigail, Ruth. Four women. The entire Bible, where marriages, you know the hand of God was there in this alliance. Eliezer, the chief servant of Abraham, comes to Haran. He comes there evening at another well. He goes down on his knees and asks God, "Lord, give me favor. My master has sent me all this way. He's old and he wants me to get a bride for his son. I'm looking unto you. Let the woman, the first woman who comes out, and I will ask her this question, and she will respond in this manner. I will ask her for water, and she will say, 'I will draw water for you, your men, and your camels.'" What does scripture say? Scripture says, as soon as he finished praying, who came? Rebecca came. As soon as Jacob reached there, who comes? Rachel comes. Where does Boaz find Ruth? Working hard in the field. Why is Jacob, so David, attracted to Abigail? Because she was a smart, hardworking wife. Question is, will you be found by God as his spouse working hard at your post? What if Rebecca did not have the habit of working hard? She wouldn't have come to that well that day. It would have been another spouse for Isaac. If Rachel hadn't come, wasn't a shepherdess, taking care of her father's flock, working hard, and came, she would have never met Jacob. If Ruth hadn't been gleaning is more difficult than harvesting, gleaning in Boaz's field, Boaz would have never noticed and said, asked, who is that girl? Remember, the women in the church, all these women represent the church. And Jesus is coming not back for a lazy, laid back church. He's coming for a church that is hardworking and who are givers. Who are givers. He doesn't change his ways. That's why we have to please be very careful. God never changes his order, because he's picking up a bride for his son, his only begotten son. When you have only one son, I think you'll be very careful about whom you pick a wife for him. And God has got only one son. So the question is, Rachel comes, something happens, and God's plan of redemption begins. Verse 18. Now, Jacob loved Rachel. Jacob loved Rachel. Laban is excited. He said, oh, you come, you stay with me for a month, everything he says. And he starts working for Laban. And Jacob says, can I have your daughter? Laban says, okay, you can have my daughter. Jacob says, I'll work 7 years for her. He gets fooled at the end of 7 years. And the father gives him the eldest daughter. And he says, you fooled me. He says, okay, it's our custom. You didn't read the small print. In our custom, we can't give the second daughter first. We gave the first daughter. It is the same custom even now in the East. We don't usually marry the elder daughter of the younger before the elder. So he said, you can have the younger. Work another 7 years. How many years did he work? You know what scripture says? The most high point of human love, still not divine, okay? Human love. In chapter 29 and verse 20. Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and there seemed only a few days to him because of the love he had for her. You know what will be written about the true church? The church served Christ Jesus for 2,000 years, and it seemed like only a few days for her because she loved Christ. Are you tiring in your service for God? Are you tired already? Are you slackening off? Simple. God never says work more. God always says love more. That's why Jesus looks at his disciples and says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. It won't be a burden for you. It will be very easy. Remember, he is not serving Rachel. He is serving for Rachel. He is serving Laban. We serve in this world. We go through the pain, the suffering, the toils, the turmoil, all the problems of this world. But we are serving for Christ. It's for him. Our reward is him. When we go out into the world, there is another ruler over there. And he's messed up the system. That's why until the second coming, nothing is going to change. But question is, who do you serve? Or whom do you serve? Nothing is going to change much for Jacob because certain laws have been broken. In Galatians chapter 6 verses 7 to 8, God says something. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, he will also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. He has already sowed much in the flesh. So have probably all of us. Do you think the harvest will change? No, it will not change. And the laws are set. We reap what we sow. Jacob will reap what he sowed. We reap later than we sow. We reap more than we sow. Jacob's harvest is going to come. What is sowed in his father's house, he will reap next 20 years in his father-in-law's house. Jacob is now on the receiving end. And Laban is more than his match. And Jacob, like all of us, will probably now learn through experience what Esau must have felt, what Isaac must have felt when he deceived them. That law never changes. Some of the best lessons are always learned by experience so that we don't repeat it. He deceived Esau, his elder brother. He deceived his father, and his father-in-law will deceive him all through. Then you will know, oh, this is how it felt. This is how it felt for him when I did this to him. In his mercy, in his love, God allows us to experience it so that we will stop sowing in the flesh and we will start sowing in the spirit. There is another law too. The other law, sad law, is when we reap in the flesh or sow in the flesh, we involve others who are innocent too in our pain. Verse 31 of Genesis 29. What does scripture say? What did the Lord see? The Lord saw that Leah was unloved. Leah loves Jacob. Jacob is obsessed with Rachel. Leah will be locked in an unhappy marriage for the rest of her life. Poor thing didn't sow this. Poor thing did not ask for this. This was a decision that was taken solely by her father. And many people are locked up in unhappy marriages because it was a decision never taken by them. Or it was a decision taken in the flesh. That is why physical attraction can become fatal attraction. God says, you can end up reaping more than you sow. But through all these 20 years, Jacob will grow. It will be extremely 20 difficult years, but as long as he keeps on giving, he will grow. As long as you and I keep giving, we will grow. You stop giving, you will stop growing. That's the principle. And through these 20 years, probably one thing sustains him. You know what is that? His love for Rachel. But please remember, this is still not godly love. Because his love is conditioned by what? The recipient. 29 verse 17. Leah's eyes were delicate, but Rachel was beautiful of form and appearance. That's why he loved her. Right? She was good looking, extremely good looking, and he fell in love with her. So his love is conditioned by the recipient. Much of our love has got to do with outward things. You know what worldliness is? Worldliness is basically an obsession with beauty without a corresponding love for holiness. When God talks about beauty, God says, worship God in the beauty of His holiness. Much of human love is connected with beauty. But God will change it for him. When you look at chapter 33, verses 1 and 2, Scripture says, Jacob lifted his eyes and looked. This is 20 years later. Esau was coming. With him were 400 men. So he divided his children among Leah, Rachel, and the two maidservants. Look at him. This is a father whose love is entirely conditioned by the recipients. All 12 are his children. And there is supposedly the enemy coming and he could bring death. What does he do? First he separates the wives. The two maidservants, the concubines and their children in the front. Behind that, the first official wife and her children second. Third, your special darling with her two children at the rear. He put the maidservants and their children in the front, Leah and her children behind, Rachel and Joseph last, Benjamin is still not there. Then he crossed over before them and bowed. He says, okay. Are you seeing how our love is conditioned by the recipient? But this power, this love, human love, even though it is incredible that you could work 20 years for your father-in-law because you are in love with his daughter, has its limits. Because it is not of God, though it looks very godly, it doesn't have the power to change. It doesn't have the power to change Rachel. In chapter 31 and verse 19, Laban had gone to shear his sheep and Rachel had stolen the household idols that were her father's. Rachel loved Jacob. Rachel did not love Jacob's God. Jacob loved Rachel, but Jacob's love for Rachel was human love. Therefore, it had no power to redeem Rachel. She sat on her father's idols. Verse 34. When her father comes chasing, absolutely is upset because they have left, but more than that, his family idols have been taken. Verse 34 says, now Rachel had taken the household idols, put them in the camel's saddle and sat on them. Laban searched everywhere and couldn't find it. Think, you served 20 years because you thought this girl was in love with you. But when she has to make a decision, yes, I'm leaving my father's house because he's cheated my husband all these years. Okay, I will go with you. How did she go? She left her father. She took her father's idols with her. Are you getting the picture? Human love doesn't have the power to redeem. Doesn't have the power to redeem anybody. Doesn't matter how much you love that person. It doesn't have the power to redeem. Jacob's love for Rachel could not redeem Rachel. But she still clung to her idols. Rachel will die later, before reaching Bethlehem. In chapter 35, verses 19 and 20, you will see this woman whom he loved so much will die. So Rachel died and was buried on the way to Ephrath, that is Bethlehem. And Jacob set a pillar on her grave, which is the pillar of Rachel's grave to this day. I personally believe God took her out of the way. If he has to finish his work in Jacob, Rachel has become a stumbling block. Took her out. God does things which we don't understand. All we can say is, your love is perfect and your ways are always right. But remember, Jacob's love for her never dies. Years and years and years and years and later, when he's old and is about to die, in his final words, in chapter 48 and verse 7. This is an old man in Egypt, in Joseph's country. He says, but as for me, when I came to Padan, Rachel died beside me in the land of Canaan on the way when there was but a little distance to go to Ephrath, and I buried her there on the way to Ephrath. He still remembers. He says, I still remember. She died on the way. Jacob's love for her never died. But he did not change anything. This is what human love can reach. And the world is full of stories of love like this. But all these stories are conditioned by the recipient, not by God's love. God does not love you or me because I am beautiful or good looking. God does not love me either because I am hardworking. He does not love you or me because He hopes to get something out of us. He loves us because He is love. That's His nature. And it is His nature to give. Because God is humble and lowly. God is humble, meek and lowly. God does not focus on Himself. He focuses on others. That's why it's written in Romans 5:8. God demonstrates His love for us. How? Verse 8. God demonstrates His own love towards us in that while we were still sinners. We were not beautiful. In His sight we were terribly ugly. The ugliness of sin. We were not hardworking because all our righteousness were like filthy rags. We had nothing to give Him. We couldn't even enter into His presence. He came and died for us. Getting the picture? All of it started at a well. Rachel was beautiful, hardworking, and had pedigree. Good family. We had nothing. We had nothing. We neither were beautiful or hardworking. And you know what our pedigree? God says, I know who your father is. You are of your father, the devil. I know your pedigree. Are we getting it how actually false our love can be or is? Therefore, before Jacob can grow in his love and one day his love become true, Rachel has to go. Because Rachel is a stumbling block. But now his love will be colored by Rachel's son, Joseph. God is still working on him. So what does God do? He takes Joseph out of the way. Now he's clinging on to Benjamin. So God says, take Benjamin to Egypt. I have not finished working with you. I have to see that your love is perfect. That's one thing I can do with human beings. I can, if they allow, I can make your love perfect. Because I will not receive a love, glory from a love that is conditioned by the recipient. Ask ourselves, is our love conditioned by recipients? Almost 3,000 years later, the son of Jacob, the seed of Jacob, takes another weary long journey in the midday sun and comes to another well. There is another unnamed woman for whom he waits. She has had 5 husbands and was living with the 6th one. She wasn't beautiful. She had no name. She had no reputation. She wasn't beautiful like Rachel. But the son of Jacob, Jesus Christ, sat at the midday hour by the wellside waiting for this woman to come. Because God's love is not conditioned by the recipient. She didn't have to have a pedigree. She didn't have to be good looking. The whole town could call her a prostitute. But God says, I love you. Contrast Jacob's love with the love of Jacob's son. Because he is the son of Jacob. Because his father is called the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. And ask ourselves, what is the nature of our love? Jesus walked, Jesus waited, and Jesus offered
truth and grace, because love gives. And this woman, who had no beauty, no name, no reputation, nothing to give back to Jesus, was smitten by the love of Jesus and ran back to the town and said, Avo, dekho, masi aaya hai. What did she become? She became a giver. She became a giver. That's what happens when the love of God touches, genuine love of God touches your heart. You become a giver. Suddenly you see a transformation. What God couldn't do with Rachel, He could do with a Samaritan woman. She became a giver. Love gives, love keeps on giving. In 1 John chapter 3, verses 16 to 18. Today, it's communion. And as we come to the communion table, we need to ask this question. Do we come as givers or do we come as takers? By this we know love, because He laid down His life for us. We also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Whoever has this world's goods and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart from him, how does the love of God abide in him? My children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. God says love is action. It's an action verb. It's a verb. It's an action word. And you know what? He says, the nature of God's love is, it can stop giving only at death. And if you have lived life giving in the power of God, God says, even after you are dead, you will still be giving. And the book of Hebrews chapter 11 begins with the first testimony and says, even though Abel is dead, he still speaks, because he gave. He still speaks. There is something about the nature of God, even death cannot stop. It cannot stop giving. That's the nature of God's love. And God says, that is what I have poured into this church. That is what I want the church to be. It is not people who walk in self-pity saying, poor me, poor me, poor me. No. Rich me, because I have much to give, because God has poured His love into my heart. Not poor me. Think back. 2000 years back. Around roughly the same time. The Son of Man. The Son of Jacob, as I want to call Him today. When most people would be thinking about themselves in self-pity or ranting in rage at others, one man alone, His eyes is not on Himself. Yet He's hanging on a cross. Hands and feet pierced. Body bruised beyond recognition. And His eyes were full of love. And His eyes are on His neighbors. Any man at that stage, because he's very near to death and his body is racked up in pain, would say, I have nothing to give. But not Jesus, because he's consumed by the love of God, and the love of God gives till the very end. And if you are standing with me and with them at the foot of the cross, I want you to listen carefully what he's saying, because he's still focused on others and he's still giving. He looked at his mother and said, Mom, that's your son. Son, that's your mother. Take care of her. He wasn't thinking about himself. I'm very sure through all that blood-stricken face and pain, he was smiling and winking at his mom. I love you, Mommy. I can feel your hurt, what you're going through. I'm not focused on myself. I'm focused on you. If you could hear carefully, you could hear the railing, the ranting crowd, Pharisees and the others. You could hear the insults. But listen carefully. He's still giving, because he's saying, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. He's not focused on self. He's focused on his neighbor. You know why? Because God's love gives, and God's love never fails. Suddenly, one thief turns to him and said, Jesus, please remember me. He looks at him and says, thank you. Evangelism never stops. You will be with me in paradise tonight. It's so difficult for us to share the good news, right? On the cross, the sharing of the good news did not stop. Did not stop. So the love of God forever gives. Jesus said, I will not focus on myself. I will focus on the other. John chapter 19. Finally, it's the end. He said, for a moment, let me think about myself. John 19 and verse 28. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled. What must be fulfilled? Scripture. I still have to give. What? Obedience to my Father. My Father said before the beginning of time, every scripture that has been spoken, you will fulfill. So he said, one thing left. Only one thing left. What is that? I thirst. I thirst. What does scripture say in verse 29? Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a hyssop, put it in his mouth. And so when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. This love never fails. This love never fails. It cannot fail. Can never fail. And you know what blessed people we are? Because scripture says God has given all of us that love. But you know what? Like we study on Wednesdays, it's never going to happen until we apply. Give that love, you will get more of it. The more you give, the more you receive. The more you give, the more you receive. Take your eyes off yourself. There is no poor me here. The letter of Peter says, Jesus showed us a way. This is the way he showed. He says, even if you are put upon the cross, don't stop giving. Don't stop giving. Don't stop giving. And it is to that table that we come. This morning we are coming to that table. That's the only table, he said, you should remember. Remember what he said? He said, remember to do this. As often as you come together, he says, remember. Why? Because he says, more than anything else that we hold on earth within the church, he says, there is one thing that represents the love of God. He says, it's a communion table where God gave. He says, when you partake of this, remember, it was my body that was broken for you. It was my blood that was shed for you. And he says, in the same measure, I expect you to lay down your life. In the same measure. Same measure. He said. So, was the love of God perfected in Jacob? Question. Was the love of God perfected in Jacob? Yes. What Isaac couldn't achieve, Jacob did. One day, he's old. And he's going to die. Unlike Jacob, who lived 42 years after he said, I'm going to die. Jacob died after he said, I'm going to die. But before he could die, he called his sons. The 12 sons were before him. And his favorite grandsons, Ephraim and Manasseh. And now the time for blessing had come. There is Joseph. And there is Benjamin. But when he starts blessing his son, he comes to Judah and he stops and says, you will rule. My love is not conditioned by the recipient. My love is conditioned by the word of God and the will of God. You will rule. The scepter shall not pass Judah. Not Joseph, not Benjamin. What Isaac couldn't do, Jacob did. His love was, at his final moments, not conditioned by the recipient. While he was blessing his grandchildren, Ephraim and Manasseh, he crossed his hand and gave the firstborn's blessing to the younger one. Joseph said, "Dad, no." He says, "I know what I am doing."
He was blind, but not spiritually blind, because he had grown in love.
Did he still love Rachel?
Oh yes, he did. He says, "I remember.
When Jacob, I think around 40 years ago, maybe 50 years ago, I can calculate and tell you next Sunday.
Do you still remember her?"
"Yes, I remember. Exactly, I remember the spot. We were on the way to Bethlehem. Just before Bethlehem, she died. And to my grief, I buried her and I erected a pillar there."
"But is your love now constrained by the recipient?" He says, "No. It's constrained by the will of God. It is His love in my heart. And I will judge, I will bless, I will prophesy according to that love." That's why Jesus said, "Let your love be perfect. Be perfect as my Father in heaven is perfect." So, word of caution, word of advice to everybody here is, when you do it without expecting anything back. Don't expect anything back. Why do we do it? We do it because God does things without expecting anything back. Christ Jesus came and died for us when we were yet sinners. It is the nature of God's love to keep on doing, keep on giving. It should be His nature in us to keep on giving, expecting nothing back. Humanly speaking, advantage, you will not be disappointed. How can you be disappointed when you don't expect anything back? Right? It's good advice. God is never disappointed. You know that God is never disappointed? That's the nature of His love. So this morning, as we go to this table, there's only one thing God asks us before we partake of this table. He says, judge yourselves. And you know how easy it is to judge instead of looking at the entire law and the prophets. The only thing that we need to judge is, did I walk in love? Every sin against God's love. That's why God says, owe no man anything other than the debt of love. Other than that, there is should no be no debt in our lives. So this morning, as we go, partake of this table. Doesn't matter what he or she has done to you. Doesn't matter. Just as God said, it doesn't matter what you did to me, I'm still going to come down and die for you. He says, don't pick up life. Don't pick up life. For anyone who finds life will lose it. But anyone who loses life for my sake will find it. As we sing the first stanza, we'll also allow the Spirit of God to search our hearts. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, He took bread. When He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body." Which is for you, do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord." Father, this morning, as we come to your table, the table of your love, more than anything else, Lord, that we witness in thy house, this table signifies to us that our God loves, our God gives, and He holds back nothing when it comes to giving. Oh, there is a fountain that has been opened, the side of the Savior, a fountain from where it is still flowing. blood mixed with water. Love mixed with truth. Flowing, redeeming, restoring anyone who comes to you. Father, I pray we will learn to grow in love. We as your people will be givers. We too want to finish like Jacob. Doesn't matter how bad our beginning was, how many times we stumbled, how selfish and carnal we were, and our focus was always on us and what to get out of this life. I pray we too will finish. One day we too will lean on our staff. And when we bless, it will be the voice of the living God speaking through us. And it is His love, it is His word, it is His will determine our actions. Make us givers, O Lord. Thank you, Father. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It was our sins that took Him to the cross. But it was His love that kept Him there. When the soldiers came with the order to break the bones, the legs of those crucified, they found He was already dead. But when a soldier put the spear into His side, He still gave. Even in death, He was still giving. Scripture says blood and water was flowing.
Oh Father, thank you for this word, my God. Pray, my God, as we've heard the word, we know that your word will not come back void. It'll accomplish what it was sent out to do. I pray, my God, as the body of Christ, as the church, we will harness and we will apply, my God. God is love. Love covers a multitude of sin. Perfect love casts away all fear. And I pray today, my God, as we leave here, that your presence will go before us, that your grace is sufficient, that your mercy is on you every morning, that we will rely on you, my God, on your strength, on your grace to love like your Father in heaven, like our Father in heaven loves us, my God. Teach us to love, my God. Teach us, my God. Show us thy ways, teach us thy paths, and lead us and guide us in the way everlasting, my God. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Oh Father, if we have found favor and grace in your sight, my God, let your presence go before us and straighten crooked paths, my God. Oh Lord, we thank you. We thank you for today, my God. It was not Pastor James speaking, but it was the Spirit of God that spoke, my God, through him. And I thank you, Lord. I thank you. Help us, Lord, to serve in love. And no servant is greater than his master. Thank you for calling us your friend, my God. Thank you, thank you. I am a friend of God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Worthy, worthy. There's no friend like you, my God. There's no friend like you. Oh, Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for forgiving us. We thank you for cleansing us. We thank you, Father, for this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, my God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. The interpretation of your pastor's tongues today. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within it. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, who forgets not all our benefits, who heals all our diseases. Who cleanses us from unrighteousness. Hallelujah. We bless your holy name today. We bless your holy name today, my God. We just bless you, my God. We choose to bless you today. We choose to bless you today, my God. Oh, Lord, I thank you for being in the house of the Lord today. Thank you that your grace brought us here. Your mercy brought us here, my God. What an awesome God we serve. How great is your love, my God. How great is your love, my God. Where would we go without your love, my God? Where would we be without your love, my God? But I thank you today. I thank you for the cross. I thank you for the bloodshed on Calvary. I thank you that you took our sin. You took our iniquity. You took our transgression. I thank you today, my God, that we are cleansed, my God. We're cleansed. And my God, clothe us in your righteousness today, my God. Clothe us. Let us soak in your love today. Let us soak in your love, my God. and let your love be shed abroad, my God. Jesus, let us win souls today for the kingdom by the love of Jesus in our hearts, my God. Oh, Father, we thank you. We love you. We praise you. We worship you. We give you the praise. We give you the glory. We give you the honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
In the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest and abide with each one of us. Amen.